So this is the point in the presentation where I'm like, hey, can you see my screen? I hope you can see my screen. It's awesome. But yeah, we're going to talk about serverless search. But first, we had the requisite introduction slide, which I can't find my cursor. There we go. So my name is Bryan Robinson. I'm a Jamstack enthusiast. I'm a big time Eleventy nerd. You can find out more about me at brob.dev, brob.dev. I have a route there /Eleventy. You'll see all the stuff I've written about Eleventy. I'm a huge nerd about it. And then I'm on Twitter. You can talk to me there at brob. Try to keep all those branded things the same. Oh, and I guess I'm a senior dev rel at Algolia. Probably important when we're talking about something like serverless search. We'll get into that here in a minute. But first and foremost, if you're not an Eleventy nerd like me, you may not be too sure about what this whole Eleventy serverless thing is about. To that, I have to say, have you not been at like 3 of the first 4 Eleventy meetups? Because I'm pretty sure there was a presentation about serverless at 3 of the first 4, now 4 of the first 5, but that's okay, because I understand not everyone's a huge nerd like me. So let me give you an overview of what this is, if you're not quite so big into it as I am. Long story short, Eleventy Serverless is an Eleventy plugin. It is shipped with Eleventy in the 1.0 release, from the 8th release candidate, I think, all the way through all the betas that are out right now. And it lets you use all the things you love about Eleventy, but inside of a serverless function. So if a page is running Eleventy serverless permalinks, it's able to actually run that at request time instead of at build time, which means that when a user hits it, the HTML is generated and sent down the tube into the browser. How very traditional of Eleventy. That's very, very old school, like hit the server, render some data and send it down. But what can this be used for? Really anything that requires user input at request time, this works for. And we've got some examples out and about. Ben, who's still with us here, made a color contrast ratio checker. I think they even put that on with Zach as 1.0 was kind of coming to fruition. And an early version of that inspired me to create a color conversion example. It was my first foray into Eleventy serverless. Basically, it takes a color value and then spits out all the conversions. So it can take the keyword red and spit out the RGB, HSL, hex, and LCH values. So that was pretty cool and pretty neat. Then last Eleventy meetup, so that would be October, and the YouTube video is available, Knut from Sanity showed how you could use serverless and the live previews within Sanity to create custom previews of content in the content management system. Very cool. And then I wrote a Smashing Magazine article, and as you can tell, I'm a huge nerd about Eleventy serverless, where you can actually do things like generate user content and then have that displayed on the fly at request time. So Phil Hawksworth made a demo like 3 years ago called VLolly, virtual lollies, where you generate a whole bunch of values and then save it, and then it builds. And then he was using serverless functions to also show that. But he was using a whole bunch of stuff around that, not Eleventy serverless, because he couldn't do. So this is kind of an alternative to that. It's also doing some cool things with Sanity. I wrote it while I was still a dev rel at Sanity. So there's a lot of cool things in there. You can check it out at Smashing Mag. And then you can also do like really, really powerful things. Like Zach recently showed how you could use Eleventy serverless with OAuth and do gated content in the Jamstack. That's really cool. And thanks for the design effort on this one, Zach. It's a beautiful thing. So those are some examples of what you can use Eleventy serverless for. And they work and they're great and they're fun and they're super powerful. But what about progressive enhancement? It's also really good for that as a concept. And I might be overstepping here, but I think it's one of the big intentions that Zach had in creating the serverless functionality, aside from those cool things, is to make sure that we have some things around progressive enhancement. And why is that important? Well, in a world where JavaScript isn't available and you have amazing things like JavaScript instant search with Algolia, and you have a delightful search query and you don't have JavaScript available, what do you do? Maybe you push something that messed up your JavaScript code, that broke it for the browser. Or what if the user turned JavaScript off? What kind of world would that be? Well, that's fine, right? Because if JavaScript's not available, we can progressively enhance, right? We can go into JavaScript and we can have a nice fallback, and we can render things on the server, silly. Don't worry. That's not a big deal, right? Whoopsie daisy. You don't have a server. You built a Jamstack site. You have a static site generated by a static site generator, served as HTML from a CDN. Where are you gonna put all that? Now I hear you saying, me. Yes, serverless functions can render HTML and they can send that down and that works, right? But you know what I love? I love managing my entire theme in Eleventy and then managing my entire theme again with HTML, a header, footer, templates, includes, all that also in JavaScript template literals in a serverless function. That sounds truly amazing, right? That sounds like I want to do that. That sounds like a lot of fun. No, wait, I'm sorry. That doesn't sound like fun. That sounds like a lot of work and a lot of places that I could introduce a bug in my code and a lot of places where my code could break and do all... No, you know, it'd just be better if we just forgot this progressive enhancement thing. Let's just have JavaScript work, and if JavaScript works, the user gets a great experience. Obviously, that's not what we want to do. Don't give up so easily. Progressive enhancement is super important. And we love Eleventy templates, right? And we can use those same templates to render in our serverless function. And also, take a big deep breath. You seem really stressed. Just hang out for a second. It'll be okay. We'll get there. So lots of jokes, lots of explanation there. Let's dive into the code. And let's build a serverless search based on just an input that doesn't need any JavaScript to work, works inside the Jamstack ecosystem, works from the CDN, works with serverless functions, and doesn't duplicate hundreds of lines of code to get us there, right? So we're gonna dive into Eleventy serverless. And to start that, we need to go into our Eleventy config file, dieleventy.js, as we saw in Ben's presentation. And we need to initialize this plugin. And you do that, you require it at the top of your file, the Eleventy serverless bundler plugin from Eleventy, from the actual Eleventy package. It ships with it, like I said, in the 1.0 betas. If you're using 0.12, you're not gonna have this. And then we go into that, and inside of our export for this, we're going to use the add plugin method on the Eleventy config object. We're gonna pass in the Eleventy serverless bundler plugin, and then we configure that with the configuration. There's more to it than just these two lines that you can utilize, but these are the two that you have to have. You give it a name, and we're gonna use that name in our template front matter, and then you give it a directory in which your serverless functions exist. So in this case, I'm using Netlify. It is built Netlify first-ish, but you can use it with AWS Lambda. You can use it with a couple other things. You can make it work. But my functions happen to be in my Netlify folder in the functions directory. So that's initializing the Eleventy serverless plugin. Then we need to use it. And to use it, we can do this in any template that we want. So we're going to create a new template that's going to be our search template. And it's going to have a little bit of front matter. You can see here, I've got like a layout. I'm using my base template. My base template, as it turns out, has a couple of includes. So all these things are things that I'd have to be writing from scratch and putting like together the full HTML page. No, we're not going to do any of that. We're just going to use Eleventy. It's got a page title. Again, going back to what Ben was talking about with all the data cascade, we've got a title here. It's in our base. It's actually in the header include in the base. So like we don't have to worry about that. And then the first deviation from how you might have traditionally used Eleventy is this permalink YAML object, this front matter object here. Typically, in the old way of doing it, you would use a string here. So you'd say permalink colon quotation marks slash search. And then at build time, Eleventy would take that and it would create the page at slash search from this data, from this template. Instead, now we're going to give it an object, and each it can accept as its properties the key of the name of the Eleventy plugin installation that we did, the initialization in the config file. So we named it in the previous slide, search, and then I can use that as a key in my permalink object to tell Eleventy how to render and what function to use to render this. You don't have to worry too much about it. Just know that you can actually specify like 5 different serverless routes from one template. And you can also use a build property on this, a build key to tell it how to build at build time as well as at request time. And then we can utilize a new object inside of our template, the eleventy.serverless object. And I've got some unfortunate naming here, but we'll get into that. On the eleventy.serverless object, we have two big things that we can use and that we can get user input from. The first is the query object. The query object is our query parameters. So, you know, in a URL at the end, you see the question mark, and then, like in this case, query equals test. Well, that's a query parameter, and that's what's going to exist within the query object. Now, there's the unfortunate naming. I'm doing search, and searches have queries. And so it's query.query. And in this case, Eleventy serverless query query equals test from that URL. But yeah, I can use also the path in some instances. So if I had /search/:query, then anything at /search/some string would go in there. So that's helpful. I used that in my Mad Libs example. And I think Knut used it in his sanity previews example from the last meetup. So now that we have this, we actually have a page that will render, and it'll actually show an H2 that just has, in this case, the word test inside of it. But we're not done yet. We need to do some data work. So theoretically, we have a query parameter, right? That is the string that a user is searching for us. So we need to do some data work around this. And as Ben mentioned, we could do computer data around this. I'm not a huge fan of computer data because it really hurts my brain, a little less now. So thanks to Ben on that. But I like filters. I like creating plugins. I like creating that sort of thing. So anything I can do in the Eleventy config files, I like to use. So in this case, we're going to set up a filter. And what that filter is going to do, we'll get into the JavaScript in a second, but it's going to accept a string, the string that we're going to get from the users. And then it's going to do a search in an Algolia index, Algolia being the company I work for. We set up APIs for doing search. And then it's going to return back an array of results. So if we search for Eleventy, I want all blog posts related to Eleventy. And then I'm going to loop through that. And if you notice, I've got an include here. And that include is to the article.html. This is an include that I can use anywhere. It doesn't have to be serverless. I've in fact used this include on the homepage of this example site to showcase all blog posts, actually pulling in from Algolia, but you could pull it in from Markdown. And then I can use that exact same template, that exact same include in this serverless function as well. So again, I'm writing very little additional code to make this work. I think that's kind of where the power comes in here. So I want to get some results. So I have a get results filter. So I'm going to go back into my Eleventy config document, .eleventy.js, and I'm going to initialize some Algolia stuff inside of here. It's actually one of the simplest Algolia functions I've ever written. But what we do is we need to have the Algolia search SDK. That's the JavaScript SDK for Algolia. We're going to require that in at the top. And you can see here, I'm actually using the /lite directory on this. That's only going to bring in our search. There's no write functionality inside of it. It makes it a much smaller package, which is good since we're doing this at request time. Again, trying to keep that speed alive. I'm also doing .env at the top. We're going to grab some environment variables. I've got the const client. We're going to actually initialize our search client. And to do that, we need our Algolia app ID available in the dashboard and our search only key, which is actually a fairly safe key to have around in front end code as well as back end code. But I've got in environment variables for portability. And then we need to initialize an index. An index is where we have our data inside of Algolia. So this can be any string. It can be whatever matches up to the indices that you've set up inside of your Algolia instance. In this case, again, for maximum portability, it's an environment variable, but that could just as easily be a string there. And then inside of our exports, I'm going to create a new filter. That's what that pipe was in our template. So eleventyconfig.addfilter, and I name the filter, and that's actually what's available to us in the template at that point after the pipe. So I'm going to name it get results, and then it's going to accept a function as the next argument. And that function is going to accept as its argument the data from what the filter is called upon. So in this case, we're doing Eleventy serverless query query, which is just going to be a string. So I'm going to pass that string in, and I'm going to do an index.search method, which is actually going to do a search query against my Algolia index. And I'm going to pass it that query string, which is just like test or Eleventy or some string that a user wants to find. And that would be all I would really have to do. But again, I'm interested in speed because now I am at request time. So everything I do here, I want to keep as slim as possible. So I'm going to request back only the attributes that I need. So I'm going to use attributes to retrieve inside of my options object here. And I'm just going to grab the title, URL, date, and description, which are the things that I needed for my articles.html include. And then I'm going to return that as a promise. And I'm going to return that into our template as results. And then that's going to build out the list inside of this for loop, right? So I get an array back from Algolia. I loop through each result in that array, and I basically pass that data into article.html. And then all I need to do past that is make a form that utilizes this new serverless function. So I have a form with an action that goes to /search, which is our permalink. It has an input that has a few things on it, but the main thing here is it has a name, and that name is query, which matches up to the query parameter that we want. And then there's a search button, right? And I have working serverless server-side search. And basically I can come up here, I can say Eleventy, hit search, the URL changes, the URL, and then you can see here that H2 changes and all the results change. I can come in, do another search. Let's see, okay, I clicked a few too many things in this video. Do a search for CSS, all those things change, the URL parameters all change, and it all just kind of works from the templates I had set up to do all of this, right? I didn't make any new real templates for the serverless function. It's all being generated for me by Eleventy. I see some chat happening. Let me pull that up real fast. A form specific Eleventy serverless. Yeah, exactly. Sorry for the intensity, but I do love this stuff. Anyway, so let me tell you, there's one more. You do need to worry about your GITIGNORE unless you like infinite looping static generation, which I don't, to be honest. So Eleventy serverless makes a whole bunch of stuff for you in that Netlify functions directory. It creates a new directory named whatever you named your serverless plugin initialization. So in this case, search. And then it brings your includes over, brings whatever templates it needs to get the job done over. And then it brings through a whole bunch of JS that you don't need to worry about. You absolutely don't need to worry about it. But you do need to keep your index.js. And that's because inside of index.js, you can either specify to use the default event handler. So that would be for a regular serverless function in like an AWS or inside of Netlify functions. You can also override that to have Netlify's on-demand builders if you're using path names there. So you do change that and you do want to keep that. So in your GITIGNORE, you're going to ignore your functions directory that contains the function name that you created. And then you're going to make sure that you don't ignore your index.js. You could also do this inside of an Eleventy ignore file, but you probably want to go ahead and ignore these files for Git anyway. So just kind of do both there. And then that was it. We have serverless search running. We didn't have to go make any template literal strings. We didn't have to write a serverless function from scratch. All that was handled for us. And we got to just write Eleventy code that we already know. So if you want to see like the full write-up on this, I know it was intense in presentation form. I go to brob.dev/serverless-search and you'll get redirected to the blog post on it. If you want to check out some really interesting use cases for serverless, the Mad Libs article that I wrote for Smashing Mag is at brob.dev/madlibs. And as usual, all of my Eleventy content is brob.dev/Eleventy.